cool shit for the King's Anthology. And when I'm done, don't expect no apology. Stupid motherfuckers should've stepped when I warned them. I'm from the boondocks of Compton, California.
Blog Talk Radio.
G-Lew. It's the G-Lew Show. G-Lew. G-Lew. It's the G-Lew Show. G-Lew. G-Lew. Westside Wednesdays. West Coast Hip Hop. 7 to 9 p.m. Pacific. Hey. Now just kick off your shoes and relax your feet. You're now rocking to the sounds of the G-Lew League. In the game like EA, do this shit the G-Way. Do it for the black brown rules to the keyways. From the west side to east LA, Crenshaw to Huntington, Whittier to East Lake. We play the music OGs low ride to. When it's done to bang, same thing they drive by to. Every Wednesday night, 7 to 9 on the G-Lew Show. That's where the west side rides. So kick cat, kick back, fire up the slip. Cause we about to take flight on this OG ship. So call 803-4001, but don't forget to put the 914 at the front. Then press the number one to holler at G-Lew. I think I got you queued in. Hey, caller, is that you? Caller. Caller, is that you? Westside Wednesdays. blogtalkradio.com/the G-Lew Show. 914-803-4001. West Coast Hip Hop at its finest, homie. California. The G-Lew Show. Hey, we just gon' ride, homie. We just gon' ride. Hit that switch though. Original Music Group Productions. Blog Talk Radio in association with the G-Lew Show. Westside Wednesday.
Right here on the G-Lew Show, BTT Media. This is the one and only first female DJ in hip hop. This is yours truly, Uncle Jam Johnny.
Yo, what up? It's Breeze. Thanks for tuning in to the G-Lew Show on Westside Wednesdays. Hosted by G-Lew. Our sponsors, BTP Media and 93 Tweed FM Ism.
Yay, 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 yay. Welcome to the G-Lew Show, world famous G-Lew Show, Westside Wednesdays. I am your host with the most, G-Lew, your maestro for the evening. I'm joined by my lovely, beautiful co-host, Miss Queen Jean. Before we get started, let me give a shout out to our sponsors, BTP Media Group, Jeff Kwan and the Kwanglomerate, Dee Harrison, producer, author, publisher, Tweed Cadillac, 93.3 Tweed FMism, and our website, theglewshow.com, streetlevelclothing.com, and One World Magazine. And with that being said, man, we got a great show lined up for you tonight. I'm going to bring in my lovely co-host, Miss Queen Jean. She is here. Good evening, Queen Jean.
Good evening, G-Lew. How are you?
Doing wonderful, doing wonderful. Blessed.
Well, that's amazing. That's awesome.
How are you?
On a Wednesday evening, I have no complaints. You know, just blessed as well, you know. No complaints. Excited about
right.
The show.
It's a beautiful thing.
Yeah,
it's a beautiful
it
thing.
Is. Wake up.
You know what I mean?
Experience life. Make a better day out of the day. Make it a better day than yesterday. And prepare yourself for tomorrow. That's a
that
beautiful
part.
Thing.
Mm-hmm. That part. Well, Queen Jean, with that being said, we have a very, very, very special
guest tonight, an OG, a veteran, historian, icon, fashion mogul, DJ extraordinaire, original LA native, like so many titles to this guy, man. I can't even put them all in one thing. So I'm gonna let Queen Jean go ahead and spill it. Queen Jean, tell them who our guest is tonight.
We got the legendary pioneer, straight out of Compton, Scotty D. Spencer, with many accolades.
Good evening, sir. Good evening.
What up, fam? I finally get a chance to get on the G-Lew show. I've been on many times, being like a speaker, talking about the people you got on
right,
the show.
Right, right.
It's
third
my
party.
Turn. It's my turn. It's my turn. The architect is here, y'all. The architect is here.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We are excited, homie. We excited about this. I am, personally. Go ahead, Queen.
Oh, I was just saying good evening to you, Scotty.
Good evening, my dear.
How are you?
I'm blessed, highly favored, my mind on increase in all the phases of my life.
Show you right.
Y'all can go on and put that one on the show. Y'all can have that one. Y'all can have that
one. We can have that one. That's a free one. That's a freebie.
We'll let him put that in the drop. Yeah. How about that?
Right.
That could be his drop, yeah. We'll let you put that as a drop for our show.
No problem.
Oh, yes, yes. We're excited to have you on, though. I know a lot of people are excited. Your family, your friends. I see you had posted the flyer, and I was reading all the comments. So it should be a great show. And for those who don't know Scotty D, you're going to learn of Scotty D this evening because he has a journey and a lot to talk about. So,
man, it's going to be incredible.
Said, yeah.
I can't wait. Scotty D. Spencer, man. Hey, I know she has a lot to ask. I got a lot to ask. Actually, I'll let ladies go first, Queen Jean. Go ahead. I'll let you kick it off because we got a lot to talk about tonight.
Well, I just want Scotty to begin the show with letting the people know who you are, how your journey began. I know that you were actually from Morgantown, West Virginia, and you moved to California. How old were you when you moved to Compton, California?
I was like 9 years old, moving to L.A. on 111th and Budlong. That's when my journey began.
Okay,
'69 is when the Crips first started in L.A. and started like
he was at Ground
in
Zero
in my area. Yeah, Ground Zero. And I went to Woodcrest Elementary. My mom and dad had good jobs, worked for the L.A. Times. My dad worked for the L.A. Times. And my mom worked for the post office. So they kept moving up in their revenue. So we moved to a better area. We moved to 140th and Avalon, which is like a different type of neighborhood. And I learned how to play sports and stuff in that neighborhood. Then we moved to a better home back to the West Side on 111th and Dinker. You know, that's right there. Right back there again. In the hub, you know?
Yeah.
Right back there again in the block. And I went to elementary school there in Inglewood and Century Park Elementary. Then I went to junior high school at Henry Clay Junior High. And that's when the baby Crips were really popping in L.A. That was one of the schools in LA that had all kinds of different neighborhoods. Yeah, Watergate,
right.
The Block, Neighborhood, Payback, Shotgun, the Raymond. It was a few Hoovers went there too, but it was like one of those schools where I learned a lot of people. I mean, I never had a lot of problem with all the neighborhoods. I befriended everybody in every neighborhood. But, you know, they start being enemies toward one another over different circumstances. So my mom got a really good job in Compton being a manager. And
Scotty, hold on, not to cut you off. I just want to ask you this right quick while we're on this topic and this subject and neighborhood. Why weren't you, like you said, you were there for Ground Zero. Why weren't you or why didn't you ever get sucked into all of that and become involved in the gang thing when it started right there?
Well, I was involved. I didn't get to that part. I wasn't really involved like that. I was a bicycle dude. We was the only one in my neighborhood that had a swimming pool. So everybody wanted to be our friend. You know what I'm saying? We was like right there on 111th and Dinker. And but I wasn't into the gang thing. I was into like more hustling than anything. I was a sports guy. I played sports. I played football on every team that from block to block. Every block had a team, and we all played. But some of us went out to play Pop Warner. I was really good in Pop Warner. So when we moved to Compton, my mom had got a good job, and she moved. Her and my dad, they didn't really split up, but she got the job in Compton. They gave her a free apartment on 120th and Central in this apartment complex called the Dory Miller Manor. Dory Miller Manor were like a four-bedroom apartments. It was like 70 apartments over there. My mom was the manager. So everybody in that apartment complex had a large family.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe three or four people didn't have big family, but most of the people there were big families. And, I had my grandparents lived on Central and Imperial right behind the stops. And I had been going there since 1969. So I knew everybody from that neighborhood. In the back of that neighborhood would call Carver Park. So by me growing up in Dory Miller Manor, but rolling with everybody in Carver Park, I got sucked into that thing. And that's when they first started the Crips right there in the apartment called the Shetty Capri. That's where they had their meetings at. I wasn't still sure what was going on. You know, walking the neighborhood, going by to seeing the guys doing what they were doing until one day they had a parade. The LA parade right there on Central Avenue, and I've seen these two different entities, like a lot of guys coming from Carver Park and a lot of guys coming from the Nickerson Garden Project, and they got there by the stops a restaurant and start fighting. I'm like, what the heck are they doing? I didn't understand the gang thing until I start really seeing some of my friends always saying cuz. But I knew some bloods too, because my cousins lived in the 60s. I would go visit them. My cousin got shot in the eye by a BB gun. I had to go live with him all summer because he was crying and didn't think the girls were going to like him, but he was a player. So I had to go down there and comfort him, and he ended up going to school with me at Henry Clay. But by him living on 62nd in Vermont, they didn't know it was some Crips down there too, not just all Brims. So he would have fights all the time. So that's when I knew about the Blood and Crip thing, you know, that kind of like had me stuck for a minute. So I ended up going to, my mom said she wasn't going to let me hang out with my Carver Park homies after junior high school. I ended up getting kicked out of L.A. City Schools for something I got into it with up at Henry Clay. So I got kicked out of L.A. City Schools, had to go to school in Compton, which was where my mom was living at. And I didn't want to go to school in Compton because I already knew where I was coming from the West Side. I didn't even think they even knew anything about the West Side in Compton. So I go to Willowbrook, met some good people. I started hanging out with the Carver Park people even more because of where I was living at. And we got into some more stuff over there at Willowbrook Junior High. But our principal there was no joke. His name was Lawrence C. Freeman.
Yeah, Mr. Freeman
was no joke. Walking his school,
Queen already
you
know.
You better have your book in your hand, and you better have your shirt tucked in.
Yeah.
If you didn't, go and line up on the rail. Grab that rail. Go and grab that rail real quick. Grab that rail. Now, pow! He was the only one still giving fun. Oh, yeah, he had the big power. Stick your ass all in with them holes in it. But Mr. Freeman was a good man for all of us that didn't have a father in the house or a big brother. Mr. Freeman was that man of all men. He was you put it up in a dictionary and you see Mr. Freeman, man's man.
Yeah.
And he taught us to be men, but what he really did, and what he really did for my generation that came through Willowbrook, we got into it I was from Carver Park, and we got into it over a dice game with the Front Hood guys. I had just moved over there, so I didn't know what was going on. But I knew one thing. My cousin was one of the reputables from that neighborhood, the Front Hood. We get into it. They fight and everything. So after the during the fight, my cousin ran and jumped in it. and grabbed me, asked me, what am I doing in this beef? So we had to have a meeting because it was all going to Centennial the following year. And I was always kind of like a smart kid. But that affiliation, boy, made you do something that you wouldn't want to do. So my mom started seeing me hanging out with my homies more. And she said, no, you ain't going to high school with them. But Mr. Freeman promised us, if you guys graduate, I will give every last one of you guys a summer job. And all of us graduated. We all got summer jobs through Mr. Freeman. I worked at the library in Compton. A lot of my homies worked at the school, you know, sweeping and stuff like that. Some of them worked in the park being junior lifeguards. But by me working in the library, I was really, you know, tapping into, you know, reading books and you know, trying to be more of a intellect than a quip. You know, gang man.
Right.
I wanted to know more about life. And because I wanted to make my mom proud. That was the only thing I wanted to do in life, was to make her proud of me. Because she said, you keep hanging out with your homies, you ain't going to live to be 16. Then you ain't going to live to be 18. You ain't going to live to be 21. But I did all that. I'm 60 years old now. Just turned 60. So I'm looking back on that to say, Centennial High School pretty much saved my life. But before I got to Centennial, my mom said, no, you're not going to Centennial with your homeboys with all this mess. I'm getting you out to, you're going to get bused to school. I'm getting bused to school. So we were like the first ones to get bused out of the city to the valley. Which was Reseda and what was the other? Reseda, the whole Reseda area.
Reseda.
So I went to Cleveland High School.
Yeah.
Right. Reseda. The whole valley area had different schools that different people went to. Definitely in the valley. But I went to Reseda. I went to Cleveland High School. I was a good sports person, but I didn't want to play. I didn't go there to play sports for these people. I went there to get my education, for real. They would see me out there playing basketball, yada, yada, yada. And I just wouldn't participate and sign my name on playing baseball, basketball, football, none of that. Because it was like, I wanted to get back home to the hood. You know what I'm saying? I wasn't going to stay up there all day. I wanted to get back to the hood because that's where I was getting my money, you know, learning stuff, hustling, and, you know, just being around my friends. But we would get back home so late at nighttime. We would get home at night. I mean, by the time we get, you know, the time zone changes, you know, through seasons. So if I didn't get home early enough, get my chores done, get my homework done, show up to moms and pops, then I can go outside. It got to being real late. So by me staying in the house a lot, I had my little component set, and I was already DJing for my moms. And when they had their little card games, dice games and all that, I would be the one to play the music. I played the music.
Hey.
I would be the entertainer, come out and do my dancing and stuff like that.
Right.
Go ahead.
Scotty. I just want to cut in right quick again. While we're on topics, I want to just touch on it before we forget about it. But going out there, like you said, you didn't like it at first, but do you think in any way being shipped out there, bus to the valley and meeting those other type of kids and people helped you with what you were doing later that maybe you didn't know at the time? By opening your eyes to different people.
All that going to school in the valley just helped me years down the line to go where I wanted to go hustle.
Right. Okay.
That's all they did. I mean, as far as the education part, they was racist out there. They were really racist. We had so many riots at that school, man, and a couple of them was behind me. I couldn't get to the hood to get the real drugs. I was selling angel dust. I was selling weed.
Mm.
You know, I mean, we dressed nice. We weren't no bum dudes, man. We went to school fly. We had our Stacey Adams and stuff on in the ninth grade, 10th grade, 11th grade. We was fly, man. We made money. And it wasn't like the money these kids are having now, but we made legitimate money enough to get up and see the tough skin. We had Levi's, you know, and see them doggone kids, pro kids' shoes. We was buying, you know, we worked and we got Converse.
Mm.
And Kroger said, I dressed nice at school,
Wallaby.
Man, because that's how my neighborhood was. Yeah, y'all, Wallabies. I dressed nice. So the girls was liking me. I had a big brand. I had a big Godfather hats on. Everything I had on matched. I was matching head to toe. I'll shoot y'all some flicks if y'all want some. But make a long story short, I wasn't trying to do the sports. I was in the education, but I was still hustling, and that kind of got me caught up because I got kicked out of school because I couldn't get back to the hood to get real drugs. But I had to start making up synthetic stuff. Before the name synthetic came out, Scotty was doing it. I would take some tea bags and some oregano and put it together, and I would call it mahogany. And them little dudes would buy that weed from me, boy, and they'd be so mad.
Wow.
They'd get headaches. They'd go tell on me. So they came one day, and they searched my locker, and they found the mint leaves. I got some mint leaves, and I put them, the mint leaves, because it smelled like dust. Mint leaves,
right.
Straight mint leaves out the garden, and you let them dry out, and you put them in some aluminum foil. They thought it was dust, but it wasn't. And sometimes I would put like a little bit of brake fluid on it, and it made it smell like it was. Oh my God, I got kicked out.
Well, you
that,
was
man.
Cold with it, man.
I was cold
how
with
did you know all that so young? How was you knowing all that so young though? To have the
because I didn't
like
go
that.
To school. I didn't go to school for sports. I went to school for education, and them kind of schools like that, predominantly white schools. You know, you had science class.
Right.
Even when I was at Centennial, when I got kicked out, I loved science. It was something about astronomy. It was something about science that just really intrigued me. And I learned that, okay, that's PCP. I know the chemicals in it. But at the time, I didn't know, but I knew what it smelled like. I knew what brake fluid smelled like. I knew what the mint leaves did. So I knew that part. But as far as the weed part, I'm like, oh, that's weed. It looked like that. You could call it something different, oregano and tea bags.
Right. They was hot.
I mean,
they was mad
I mean,
you.
Oh yeah, hey. They got me kicked out that school. Then look, and it's the good part right here. I knew somebody would probably run up on me because back then we had these guns. They were cap guns, and they had a little red,
right.
A little red dot on the cap gun, but they would pop out.
Right.
You know, it looked
right.
Like a real gun, but it was steel. It was like a steel revolver.
Yeah,
So I took the little red. I took the little red cap out. And I had a pistol too. I had a pistol and everything. Run up on me, I'm going to pop on you. Oh, yeah, it was crazy. And it ain't about who got the gun. It's about who using the gun. Get up off me, white boy.
Right.
Get up off me, kid. Get back. They don't know you're moving it so fast. They don't know if it's real or not. And I got kicked out for that.
Wow. Okay.
Hey,
so Oh, go ahead, Queen.
I was just going to ask about these landmarks because I know when I was going to Centennial, the landmark was a Chicken Shack. Remember that? It was a liquor store where Smart and Finals is now. You had the liquor store and you had the little Chicken Shack right there. That was a ditching spot.
See,
that in Mama Nacka's.
See me, Jean, you a little bit older than me.
Oh, okay.
With your beautiful skin. My odd chicken spot was Mama Nacka's.
Yeah,
all that stuff was gone. The liquor store stuff was gone by the time we got there. It was gone, but Mama Knock was there. I mean, it was so many things happening at Mama Knock's. The dice games was like coolie hot. That was coolie hot. That place was coolie hot all day long.
Right.
Yeah.
Our
kicking spot.
On 120th and Central, you said you guys moved over there. Now, I know there's four corners. Which corner was you guys on? What side was you on? Because you got the Taco Pete, and on the other side, you got the liquor store and the other two landmarks there. So what side were you all on? Is that apartment complex still there, or is that something else now, like a medical building?
Okay, you know, on the medical building side, behind that is some apartments called the Dory Miller Manor.
Oh, okay.
The Dory
Miller
Manor, turned into, we used to all be, my mom was the manager, so we were all friends. We played baseball together, all that. If something happened, we would all do things. Like, the dude I got kicked out of junior high school with, his name is Sammy Cash, we were all in-laws, but later on they became Miller gangsters. I didn't choose that route because I was rolling with the Carver Park boys before they turned Crips. So I had knew them more than I love these guys too. But to this day, we're all still friends and everything. But back then, you know, that gang thing really separated and got a lot of people hurt just by being from a different neighborhood. Ain't that crazy? And we all live and love one another. To this day, they love my mama so much. My mom was there for all of them. For all their families, when their moms passed away and dads passed away, kids. My mom was always there until she got into her situation. She's big right now, but some of them guys even called me, hey, Scotty, man, hey, do you mind if I call your mama? And he's like notorious murdering dude. They have been in prison for 30 years, killing up people and stuff, but they want to know how my mama doing. You know, so
that's cool.
That just shows me that this gang thing is like, it was never meant to be for us to like really jump into that. I mean, I went to Job Corps after Centennial. I got kicked out of Centennial too. I got kicked out.
I was going to Centennial though, Scotty. Being from Carver Park, that's all flood school, right?
Okay, heck no. It's never been
but that's
all.
Yeah, in the city of Square, you had one side. We were talking about this last night. One side is where the Bloods hung out at, and on the other side, closer to El Segundo, is where the Crips. That was the Crips side. The Blood side was closer to. Yeah, so it was always Blood and Crips.
And that was like
Centennial.
That. It was split down the middle, even with your locker situation. My first day of school, somebody made a mistake and put my locker on the Blood side. I don't know. I got almost kicked out of school my first day of school for bringing a gun on campus and shooting it.
Yeah.
They couldn't prove it, but they told on me, and they watched me for a long time, but later on they got me. They got me about a year later.
Yeah.
I stayed active. I was the first one to do I didn't want to gangbang no more. All my homies, we was just steadily fighting people that was cool, and I don't know. I went there to, like, same thing, get my education. I didn't want to play no sports. I wanted to get educated and play with them girls. And all the dudes I knew, we was all blue rags. We wanted to get red rag girlfriends to make them dudes mad. That was the whole purpose of gangbanging. Well, mine was to make them mad. And you can't, we ain't going to fight. You can't get me, but I got your girl. That type of stuff. And that led into me having a child by one of them. She had on red panties. I had on blue drawers. We made a little black baby.
Okay.
It was fun. Centennial. That was one of my highlights of my life. Man, going to Centennial was so fun. My baby mama was like, is 2 years older than me. She's 2 years older than me. So I went to her senior prom. I went to her senior, all that senior stuff. Every senior event, I was there. You know what I'm saying? They didn't like me because I was raw. I was, I didn't care. I'd get on the stage and start going out there, crip walking and stuff. And then all the dudes that was in the 12th grade that was other Crips, like, Scotty, why you representing so hard? And even my dudes from my neighborhood was like, man, what's happening with you? So they start getting kind of sparked. But the OGs were always telling me, Scotty, man, come on, man. You got to, lean back a little bit and start, find something else to do, man. You got to go to, you can't do this all the time because you're bringing it back on. I ain't bringing nothing nowhere. I'm not starting nothing. I'm just doing what I thought you were supposed to do when you're representing Crip. You're supposed to have your blue rag on and everything on, you're supposed to be blue from the head to the toe, your glasses, your hat. And that just wasn't with everybody. I was flashing too much, too flamboyant with it. I should have been laid back. And I didn't make a lot. I made some enemies, but I didn't make a lot. I had a lot of little girlfriends, but I got kicked out of school because I started this thing. I didn't want to gangbang no more. One day I got high, and I went to the senior square and told everybody, today is my last day cripping. I dropped my rag. And I said, I'm pop locking. So I got a group together. Two of them was Bloods, and six of them was Crips. And the security told us we can use a place. If I stay out of trouble for a week, they would give me a place to start rehearsing with my group. Me and my group, we did a lot of things. We started doing shows in Vegas. We had a lot of different opportunities. One of the security guards ended up being one of our managers. He turned us on to some other people. But I got kicked out because one of my homeboys from my hood didn't like it. He couldn't get into the Mr. Centennial contest. So he knocked out the dude who won the Mr. Centennial contest, and I happened to be with him. So I got suspended. I'm already on probation because I got busted out there in the valley hustling. I told you, I knew about that valley. I know we went back out there hustling.
That's what I was going to get to you later. Yeah. When that's where you met King T, right? But we'll get to that.
Nah, that was way later. I'm high school, man. Okay. King T and them little kids, man. They're my children playing in my realm, man.
Right, no, I'm saying later on when you said you went back to the valley, I said later down the line when you said you were back in the valley doing some hustling.
Right, that was like God sent, man, because let me finish this right here. So I get kicked out of Centennial. My probation officer told me you got a choice. Since you're doing good in school, we got a choice. I'm going to send you either Job Corps or you can go to YA. Now, I know what YA is. I done been in every juvenile hall in L.A., Las Padrinas, Silmar, and Central. You know, I've been in, so I know what's about to go down in YA. I knew that's Gladiator School. I didn't need to go there. So I said, well, what is Job Corps? He said, well, you can go there, get your trade, you know, all this kind of thing. I'm like, oh, sure, I can make my mama proud. So I go, they send me out to Clearfield, Utah. In Clearfield, Utah, that's where I went to Job Corps at. The first day I walked in the dorm, when I got on the airplane, I met like three dudes, and they were from different neighborhoods in L.A., and they was all from East Coast, different neighborhoods in East Coast, 6'9", 7'6", right. I'm like, what, the East Coast, for real? I didn't know. I didn't know that. And I lived on 70, I had my own place messing with my mom and dad because he had HUD. He worked for HUD. So I had my own place on 79th and Central. Before I went to Job Corps, I had my own place as a juvenile. I was doing grown people stuff. So I go to Job Corps, meet these guys, walk in this dorm, and I heard this sound I never heard before. It was somebody in this little cubicle rapping, like chanting. I looked in there, and I seen somebody chanting. I said, what you doing? So I'm rapping. I'm like, really? Hey, can I come back and holler at you? He said, yeah. So I go in, do my orientation. I come back and holler at him, and he tell me he's rapping, and he's from New York. His name was Tony C. I'm like, oh, wow. I'm intrigued. I'm going to get everything out this Job Corps place. I'm going to get my education. I'm going to get my trade. I'm going to get everything I can, but I'm getting all this music that he's playing. I'm going back to L.A. I'm going to be the dopest DJ. I'm already knowing everybody in L.A. I'm already a DJ in L.A. So I'm going to be dope now. So I go on with that for about a year. It's time to come home. And Christmas time, when I get to the house in 1979, right before Christmas, I run into these guys in Compton that were from New York, from Castle Hill, New York, and they called themselves the Sound Master Crew. BJD, Little Richie C, Wiz Kid, Derek, and while I'm in Job Corps, I meet my partner, DJ Juan. Juan is with me, but Juan already knew these guys too. Before he even came to Job Corps, he had just got there for a couple of months, but he had already met them in Compton. So they end up being really good friends of mine. To this day, we've been in the paint, you know, almost 40-something years together. And I just went to their hood day out in New York. I mean, the Sound Master is a big, Just Ice is a Sound Master. He's one of the originals that my guy, DJ D, was DJing with in New York. When he come to L.A., we come to Compton, Coolio lived across the street. So he was with us. Spoon C was with us. We had a cool thing going on in Compton. I mean, break dancing. I didn't really know what L.A. was doing because I didn't really venture out like that other than going to hustle. I went to the workshop because I was a dancer. That's 92nd and Weston. I was going there all the time. So I knew about the workshop. I knew about the Carolina West because I loved to dance at that time. But I wasn't going to, like, the big dances and trying to be known and stuff like that. Most of the time I was going to places to see if I can hustle at other than dance. So when DJD was doing a party one night, Uncle Jam's Army had just came out and they had did their dance. I got there late, so I said, next time they do a dance, I'm going. I went to the second dance, passing out flyers for the Sound Master Crew, ran into Roger Clayton, and he asked us to perform at the convention center. This is before the sports arena. And my guys went down there with the turntables and rapping, and they were the first ones on the stage to me to do it, you know, in front of a crowd in L.A., and it seemed like everybody and mama started doing it afterwards. This was like Roger's third dance, and that was at the convention center. So I say myself, Uncle Jam's Army bought the water, Sound Master Crew bought the concrete. We mixed it up together on the stage that night, and we laid the foundation for West Coast hip hop.
Legendary. Legendary.
Just my opinion, though. Legendary. Just my opinion.
Right. How were those days?
Now, that was, this is in like 80. This is like 81, 82. All up in this to like 83, 84, I started my, I bought some stock into this company called J&D, the exclusive custom sportswear. I was working at the shipyard. I left from the shipyard and started working at the gas company. And I had another side job being an undercover security guard in the valley. up in San Fernando Valley. And it was one of my friend's company, and he knew I'm a veteran. So he said, "Scotty, yeah, you got a little, you know, you got a little leadership skill, so I need somebody with your skills to help me with my security. I'll make you like a sergeant." I'm like, "Well, I'll do that." So I go out there and say, putting people in jail, I would make them like, come look at my trunk and my sweatsuits I'm making right here, with the feeling down the arm and leg and the Gucci suits and all that, you know, with my partner, LZD Van Scott, rest in peace. You know, that's Kanye West. My partner is Kanye West's first cousin. His little cousin is still with Kanye West to this day, and that's what my film, I got a film coming out. I got about 9 hours of film already done, but the part we're working on right now is called The Fila Shop Story, which includes everybody, DJ Pooh, King T, and I'm letting them know that Kanye West was always around. He used to come around a lot. And not just him, it was this lady that was a big-time drug dealer named Thelma Wright. Thelma Wright is from Philadelphia. I've seen her story. Yeah, I didn't know. Okay, you saw her story, but I didn't know until last November who she was. I thought she was just a cute lady working with us, bringing thousands of dollars. She, first time we met her, she bought $25,000. Then she come with $40,000. Then she come with $60,000. Then one time she come with $100,000+. I'm like, wow. Okay, I never thought, because back then everybody was making money. Every fine girl had a short Anita Baker haircut, smelling good with a drop top bend. Everybody, you was nobody different from the next person. We didn't know that she was funneling money through our company. You know what I'm saying? Taking that money from pretty. We didn't know. I didn't know until, like I said, November of last year. I called my partner, a cousin named John. He's Big John is Kanye West's head of security, which is Kanye West's first cousin. I said, "Big John, you know I'm doing my story on the Fila. I need to make sure that you are with it when I go get this endorsement from Fila, you know, to do a signature line. I need your back. I need you to have my back. I got you. I don't worry about nothing. Yo, but you need to talk to Thelma." Talk to Thelma about what? You ain't seeing her stuff like, nah. Man, Google her and look up her stuff. So I started looking it up, and I was going crazy. Like, oh, this lady got me. Got all of us. So I did like a 2 or 3 hour interview on her, and all of us got together at the Sheraton over in the Ventura Boulevard. We got over there. We had a big, long, huge family reunion. It was so beautiful. We supported one another. We talked. And she told us everything. The reason why she loved us, because we never got at her like that. We got at her like a sister, like a real partner. She felt safe with us. You know, she had all that money. She just felt safe being around us. I'm like, wow, that's crazy. You never know who around you, let you close mouth and get fit. So that's part of my story. When I opened up my shop in the valley, in Pacoima, Pacoima Valley, over there with WAC 100 from.
Right.
100 was around back then.
Right.
So right there at Pacoima, we had a,
Go ahead.
Yeah. Right there on Van Nuys and Glen Oaks is where my shop was, in the Arco parking lot. I mean, Bo Bennett. It was so suave. It was so many entertainers came through my shop. It's crazy. The New Edition, Mike Tyson, Blair Underwood. So many people came to Jazzy Jeff the Fresh Prince. You know, it was just, that was like the hot spot of the valley for that time zone. And we was making a lot of money, but the police thought we were selling dope. We were selling dope. We were selling dope clothes. I didn't sell dope no more after I started my shop, man. I just couldn't. I didn't see myself doing it. I was making so much money, and I was going out of town, and we had so many out of town. Everybody in the nation had a store in their area, and most of them guys wanted to, you know, funnel their money in the right way, so they started coming to California buying clothes from us. We had our own outlet way before any other hip-hop clothing line ever. Even Dapper Dan, he was making high fashion clothes at the time. When Grandmaster D and them started coming out to California through Uncle Jam's Army, Roger Clayton, I would pick them up. I would take them straight to my warehouse. I would pass Roger up, because me and Roger was right down the street from one another. He was on Van Ness at the DJ booth. He had just moved it from over on Flosser. He had the DJ booth there on Van Nuys and El Segundo, and I was on Normandy and El Segundo. So I would pass him up and take him straight to my warehouse, and they would go crazy up in there. Like, oh, shoot, what are y'all doing? Oh, I ain't never seen it like this before. So my man, Grandmaster D from Houdini, he was one of the big customers. Him and Eric D from Eric D and Rock Cam, they were really good customers. Grandmaster
right.
D went to Dapper Dan, and Dapper Dan saw the look. He saw what we were doing. And I'm not saying he seen the look. So he started doing it his way. Because he wasn't doing it at first. And that's the timeline of where I'm at.
That's history. You were before Dapper Dan.
Grandmaster D.
That's history.
Yeah. So
wow.
We were J&D, the exclusive fucking sports, whatever, before that. And it's proof because Grandmaster D put me on the phone with the man. We talked for a few minutes. He said, I like your stuff. And that was it. It wasn't no big, long. I mean, you can say he forgot. I don't remember. Anyway, I got it on videotape. I recorded Grandmaster D in conversation. We brought it to Foration. He said, yes, Scotty, but you gave him the look. I didn't give him no design. I didn't give him not one pattern. I gave him what? The look. This is
right.
Hip-hop. And it wasn't a name back then. We were doing it before it had a name called hip-hop. You know, everything I was doing, helping these guys get into record deals and stuff, it didn't have a name called hip-hop. We were doing it since 1979.
Mm.
And so back to my shop in the valley was so hot, I had a DJ booth in there where had a couple of DJs. We would DJ parties, weddings, and stuff like that around the area. So I needed equipment. So a couple of guys from Uncle Jam's Army wasn't really getting a lot of money. So I asked them, they come up, you know, on the weekend, DJ Pooh and Cold Crook Chris, come up, bring the sound system, y'all help me out, you know, and I pay y'all. They didn't pay. Everybody's going to move around to get paid. So I ended up making one of them, my manager was Chris, Cold Crook Chris being my manager. First, this is my cousin, Big Pete, just got a prison from the front hood. So I said, look, man, you ain't going back to prison. You're going to work here, too. And DJ Pooh. So one day I'm coming to my store to come drop. I was going to college at the time, Valley College, for a fashion designer. I pull up at my store. I see this dude, you know, in front of my store, looking all through my window, little skinny kid. Like, you know, he didn't look like he looked kind of thuggish. You know, I'm like, he's going to steal something.
Right.
Ask him what he wants. He said, man, this your stuff? I said, yeah, it's my stuff. I said, help me get the stuff out of my car. I said, he came in. He seen the turntable. He said, oh, man, you got turntables. Ask him a little realistic. There wasn't no techniques at, because Chris and Pooh would bring up the techniques on the weekends. Oh, man, I can get out like that. Who you with? Oh, man, I'm with Uncle John's Army. Really? Who you know with Uncle John's Army? Oh, I'm with DJ Bobcat. For real? Okay, so he on me. Oh, like, man, so the next day I brought DJ Pooh with me. I said, Pooh, you know him? He said, no, no, a little dusty dude, man. Who was that? I said, oh, his name is Terry, man, Terry T. He said, man, he lying here with us. I said, okay, cool. Play it off. So Terry T, I had a rap contest that weekend. So Terry T got in it. With Lemon Lime and them came through. A lot of guys from the Valley, J-Bro from the Alcoholics, they all came to my store. Him and Swabby D had a group. So they came to my store. We had a little rap battle. And DJ Pooh was like, I like him right there, which is Terry T. And DJ Pooh worked with Terry T for a couple of weeks, man. Next thing you know, I come to the shop, and DJ Pooh changed Terry T name to King T.
Wow.
But King T came through. J-Bro from the Alcoholics came through. Swabby D. Exhibit and all of them came later. But those are the core guys who started with me.
So J-Bro is
DJ
day one,
Pooh,
too.
Oh, yeah, J-Ro day one, baby. J-Ro day one. J-Ro didn't even want to rap for me back then. His cousin stocked him in the back and made him rap for me. Man, this old dude don't know nothing about rap. You know, I'm making clothes. He coming in trying to get some clothes, man, and the name on his clothes was called Hitman. He was a Hitman, J-Ro Robinson, right? And I'm like, what's the Hitman for? Oh, he said, I'll be busting. I said, busting? Like, you rap? He said, yeah, I rap. I said, bust something then. He said, oh, nah, man. He didn't want to rap for me because I looked older, you know. I looked older.
Right.
And I was older than them guys. He didn't want to rap, but his cousin made him rap. And I told him to come up that weekend, you know. And I ended up putting a record out on them. I executive produced King T's first three records and J-Ro and Swabby D's first record. They had a song called Buck Lee. King T had It's a Disaster, The Story is Told, and some other record. But, you know, that's what they were doing. I put them on shows where, like, when the rappers would come, with Uncle Jam's Army would book. See, I rode with Roger from day one. After the show that we did with him at the convention center, man, Roger was from that point forward. So every time he would do anything, put up posters, that was me, I'm right there with him. You know. So we were tight all the way. You know, I never asked Roger for no money because I had my own money. We getting tickets to get in the show. It was all like, that's my brother. All the way until when he passed away, we were still hanging up posters for Keith Sweat right before, you know, he passed away with that. So Roger didn't mind me. He didn't mind me taking his crew to go hang out with me because we were still family. So when he would do shows like with Ice-T, the Real Roxanne, Whistle, or whoever would come out, Jazzy Jeff and them, we would put local acts on the show like the Dream Team or whoever. And that's how he kept it going. So I said, man, what about my group? What about King T, DJ Pooh, this and so? Well, bring them. Bring them. Come on, we're going to put them on. They're going to be the open acts for real. And he let that happen for these guys. They didn't even have records out, and they were opening up for different major acts at that time. So they learned from me. Then one day they had a contest at my shop. DJ P said, "Listen, guy, you bringing Houdini? We want to DJ. We want to battle Grandmaster D. That's your homie. We want to battle him." So Grandmaster D didn't come, but Ecstasy and Cliff Love and Lance Romance, Jaleel, and Bobby Brown came in my shop. I didn't even know who Bobby Brown was. He was sitting in the back seat of my Cadillac. I'm like, this dude so look familiar. But when he got to my shop, the girls said, "Oh my God, that's Bobby Brown." I'm like, "Oh shit, Bob." So Bob said, "Look, hey, Scotty, man, y'all got a DJ. Hey, I got an album coming out called Girlfriend. I want you to DJ my house party and my party for my album." I'm like, "Cool, we'll do that. We did his house party and all that." So our names started getting big. John Amos came over. He wanted me to. John Amos from Good Times. We did his
good
party.
Good Times people. Right, right. He just like casually saying,
so we
yeah.
Was like, we were really kind of big in that valley, man. That valley had us 3 feet high and rising. But DJ Pooh, he said, "Look, Scotty, these people want me to come to New York and be in their group." So I sent DJ Pooh to New York to be with Houdini. It kept falling. He wasn't going according to plan. But while he was out there, L.A. Posse, Daryl and Dwayne from L.A. Posse, they were already out there doing production for L.L. Houdini and Run DMC and stuff like that, trying to get on because Lux were assigned them to a deal. And they brought out this kid named Breeze. That's the guy that they were working with. And then they needed some scratches, so they bought Bobcat out. So when they bought Bobcat out, they just happened to run into Pooh one day at the office, and Pooh ended up starting coming over and, you know, helping with production, and they all family, man. God, it was all God's divine destiny for us all to still remain friends like we are to this day. And that's why I called my film How the West Was One. You know, we were all one unit. We would do shows, it would be like 7X, and we only got 4 rooms. You had to pull out the mattress, get in the bathtub with the toilet paper rolling. It was crazy, man. We had to do like we was all in the county jail. You know what I'm saying? But we was on the road having fun with this thing called Uncle Dan Lonnie, man.
It's a beautiful thing. That's a beautiful thing. Hey,
and it was new violence back then when we... Go ahead.
No, I was going to say... The phone lines are lit up, man. We got a couple callers out there I just wanted to take right quick, if you didn't mind, man, because they've been holding on a minute. Okay, let me take a couple callers. Caller, hello, you're live on the line, 661.
661, that's me?
Yes, it is.
How you doing?
Hi, Scotty, this is Val. Val Michelle, and Smokey Val. I just said,
"Hello."
Hey, baby, I'm listening to your stories and reminiscing, so I just want to give you a shout-out, let you know I'm here, baby.
Thank you, dear. Miss you.
All right. Talk to you later.
Have a good one, Queen.
All right, thank you. Okay, let me see. 702, you're live on the line.
Yeah, this is Craig from Skateland USA wishing Scotty D the best.
Wow.
Skateland USA.
Wait.
Hold on. Y'all got to stop the presses, man. Y'all got to stop the presses, man. That's Craig Schlossinger. That man right there, he's the one that opened up Skateland after
it closed down. Wait a minute. Scotty D, I forgot to say, the Skateland USA Compton.
Compton, the right there on Central. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Got to put it out there.
Well, Craig is the man. Craig and his family came back in there, and they reopened up the bowling alley, and they made it a beautiful
space.
Craig brought it in and reopened it, bought Lonzo, DJ Slip, and Roger, and Greg Mack over there, and look what happened. It's a part of our West Coast history. That's one of the first skating rinks that had, you know, mobile, you know, we had the rappers and stuff coming in. That was incredible. That was some good times, man. NWA.
That's
first
a historian
show.
Landmark. Historian
we
landmark.
We actually had
there.
A live, we had a live feed for K-Day every Friday night for Greg Mack's Friday Night Jams.
Wow.
And we would put Craig, thank you for calling in. Craig called
man,
me.
Man, this is his
Craig
story.
Loved me, man.
This is his
I know Craig loved me, but I didn't know Craig. I didn't know Craig
loved
me like
Craig
he do.
Like
Craig
that.
Called me. We talk at least once or twice a year, man. Craig called in for his boy. That's right, Craig. We're going to keep him in.
Yeah.
I love you, man.
Thank
right.
you, sir.
For me out here, it's 11 o'clock. Yeah.
I got to tell you, man, me and the Felicia, the Porters, we're going to be calling you like in like the next couple of weeks. We're doing the West Coast the 50-year of West Coast hip hop out here on the West Coast, and we're going to give you a shout out. It's going to be beautiful.
I get your email. I mean, I get your texts and your Facebook.
Okay. Okay.
I don't know if you get mine, but I get yours.
Yes, sir.
So
I love
me,
you, man. Thank you, Greg.
Where are you at tonight, Scotty? Where are you at? All
right now.
What's going on?
I just pulled over in Arkansas. I'm on my way back to California. I came from the East Coast handling some family business. And I just pulled over in Arkansas on the way back to Las Vegas right now. I'm in Arkansas right now.
Well, listen, you guys have a good time on the air. Who's our host tonight, by the way?
This is G-Lew. This is the G-Lew Show, sir. And I'm with Queen Jean, my co-host.
Okay, Queen
How
Jean, I love it. I'm good, darling.
Thank
How
you
are you?
For calling in. I'm great.
It's all right.
Thank you for calling in. Yeah.
That's right. It was we were significant to West Coast hip-hop. We were significant to gangster rap. We brought in NWA. That's where they got their start, right there, Skateland, USA.
Yeah. We've Compton. Had somebody else on the show before, and they brought that history up. So, yeah. I'm from Compton as well. So, yeah, I'm so familiar with that historian landmark. That's why I said it. Because at one time it had became Kazuri. It had became a Kazuri place where they were selling all the Kazuri products for colleges.
Kazuri tried to buy our building, and we wouldn't sell it to them because it wasn't priced right. And then we sold it to a guy that owned a big trucking company downtown, and he sold it to Kazuri, and he operated the hair care business out of it for quite some time. I don't know how long he did it.
Yeah.
It's eventually gone. Tore that puppy down.
I went and got all my tools from there, my everything, my stove, my curling irons, everything came from that location when I was going to cosmetology school.
So you saw all those forklifts and boxes on top of that beautiful maple floor from Dolly, Wisconsin, didn't you? Yes, you did.
Definitely, yes. But we thank you for calling in. We highly appreciate
my pleasure.
It.
If Scotty D's on, I'll call in again. Scotty D, be safe. Have a good time going back.
Yes, sir. Love you, man.
Take care,
Craig.
Thank you much. Take care.
Good night.
You, sir. Historic right there. Historic. Much love. Man, that was historic right there, people. We got one more call. I've got one more caller. We'll take my man, hold on for a minute. 267 Philly.
Hey, what's happening? Live from the 215. How y'all living
good evening,
out there?
Good evening.
Good evening.
Hey,
good evening.
I'm good. DJ Maniac. Just calling
DJ
out.
Maniac.
DJ Maniac. This homicide right here. What up, Maniac?
Just calling up and say much love and respect to DJ Scotty D. I love the Compton. It got to be bumped. City of Compton. My favorite producer and the greatest producer of all time, DJ Quick, is from Compton. And I want to say, like, much love and respect to your music and career.
Oh, thank you, brother.
No problem.
Thank you, DJ Mania, for chopping
You're
in.
Welcome. Anytime.
Thank you, sir. Much love, man. Thank you, man. Much love to Philadelphia, Illadelph.
Thanks. Much love.
I like the way he changed. I like the way he changed the narrative right there, talking about DJ Quick. See, now, Quick is one of the most underrated producers.
Very underrated.
Ever.
Right?
Ever. I mean, he got that percussion stuff down. Him and my man DJ Scratch, they had that percussion stuff going way back before anybody else was doing it. You know, second and nine, high speed. You know, everybody that was.
Did you ever get to work with Quick?
Tweed Cadillac and Player Ham.
That's my man.
Well, I did promotion.
That's my man.
I did promotion. The thing that DJ Quick did for me.
Right. Okay.
The thing that DJ Quick did for me, I was one of the top promotion guys, because when King Kingdom album came out, they didn't know anything about street promotion. Uncle Jam's Army did street promotion. So me and Roger Clayton started a company called Platinum Street Promotion, because we knew how to do promotions. So at one time, we had so many contracts, Roger didn't have time to really help me do the promotion, so I started doing it myself. And it got to the point where DJ Quick had an act called Sugar Free, and the album was called Street Gospel. So they called me to come up to Island Records with my man Faye Devonator. Faye Devonator is the first person who gave me my start in street promotions and my first project in street promotions by myself personally, to lay the blueprint on how to do street promotions in L.A. Lay the blueprint out. I went to the library, try to figure out how to do an invoice. You couldn't get none of that stuff back then. We had to actually write the blueprint. I had to call my man Doug Young to help me do the invoice. I knew how to do the proposal. So my man Richard Fareed and Roger, we put the proposal together to do promotion for all these different acts that were coming out, because Roger had hooked up with everything in New York, from Run DMC, Uptown Records, you know, the Good Girls, Heavy D and the Boy. We had all that stuff coming, but we was never doing it on a professional level with a package. We put together the first promotional package, you know, and we gave it to Capitol Records for King T. You know, these other guys end up being big time guys in the game. I ain't gonna even say their names because it don't matter right now. But I had got so big when I got the Interscope contract. And I blew up Tupac so big that everybody and their mama was coming at, even Death Row, because I was trying to get on with Death Row. The reason why I really did that, to get on with Death Row, because I know I was over there, going over there with Dick Griffey, over to the studio, helping Dick Griffey doing some other R&B. I was doing R&B before I was even doing rap promotion. So they would tell me about this Chronic thing and Dre. Every time I would see Dre, I would say, Dre, man, what's happening, man? You going to put me on the wall? I got you, Scotty D. And he never put me on. So I went to Interscope. They gave me the job. I blew up Tupac so much because I knew where Dre lived at, how they came to work, how Sugar came to work. You know, I knew everybody who worked in the office and where they lived at. So I put posters everywhere. And it was all Tupac stuff, right? And one day they came down to the office because something happened at Interscope where they had leaked one of the songs on the Chronic. I think it was like Let Me Ride or whatever it was. They leaked it, and Shig went down there and five heartbeats everybody in the office. Everybody got that five heartbeats,
right.
You know, concept, and everybody
right.
got five. There was nobody there but just Faye by himself. So when I came in to asking for a job, he gave me a job. Look, Scotty, you work on the streets for 3 days a week, and come up here to the office and work at least 2 days until I get somebody to help me out up in here. So I used to go up in there and work with him. And I ran the street team, so I put together guys all across the United States. You know? So one day, one of the guys from Death Row came down looking for who was doing the promotions on Tupac. And the guy who came down, rest in peace, now I love that man, his name is Big Jake. Big Jake got killed in Atlanta.
Big Jake.
Big Jake came down and got me to come and have a meeting with Suge. I went up there to the meeting with Suge. Suge gave me the most money I ever had in the whole music industry just to do exclusive promotions for Death Row Records. So I was there from the beginning all the way down until it was over with. I was one of the last people to get laid off. And they start giving out the letters. I was one of the last persons. I still got my letter. But yeah, so me doing all that, I started getting everybody, and I started doing mixtapes on the streets too with my man DJ Sean. So we had Quiet Storm, Hitting Hard, Summer Jam. That was up. I mean, everybody had a Summer Jam tape or a Hitting Hard tape or a Quiet Storm tape. We were doing that, and we were getting all of our stuff, you know, directly from the labels because I was doing a street promotion. So I would go into them companies and get them records before it came out or get a DAT or whatever, and we would put it on a mixtape. So one day, Island Records, Faye Devon, they had moved on from Interscope to Island, and he said, look, I need you to come up here and have a meeting with me, and I got this kid I need you to help me with. And the guy's name was Sugar Free. And we promoted Sugar. Mm. That's a classic right now. I need my plaque. Anybody who's listening out there, Tony Lane, you know, I love you, man. Hope you feel better and get better. Big Chubb, you know, where my plaque at, man? I need my plaque, Sugar. Give my plaque. Because that was like an album that you had to figure out. Yeah, you had to figure out a whole different way and a method to promote this guy. His album is called Street Gospel. You can't take it to the church. But right. It's not that record. You know, I had to take him to, like, all the strip joints. I had to take him straight to the real Holstro. I had to go to every motorcycle club in L.A. You know, L.A. is like every night it's a different motorcycle club event going on 7 days a week. I had to take him to the right. after hours. You know, people don't know about the after hours with Doobie and BJ and all them guys, man, that were, you know, rest in peace, that had after hour joints, man. So I had to do... come up with a different way and a plan to promote this guy, and he ended up being a hood classic, you know, off that street that's wild.
Yes, sir, to this day. They love Sugar Free.
We promoted over 100 acts, you know, corporate products, you know, house parties, wedding receptions. We did a lot of different stuff together, and I just happened to have my name attached to it.
Man, what haven't you done, Scotty? You've done it all, man. Jesus Christ. And we ain't even midway through.
It wasn't me that was doing it. God just happened to give me the keys, like a maintenance man, to somebody had to do it. And I'm like, sometimes I'll be thinking about why me? And I got to say, why not me? Because I'm not going to just talk about myself. I'm going to say Doug Young. I'm going to say Roger Clayton. I'm going to say Sir T. You know, in Central Cali, that was making it. I'm going to say Al Robinson in the Bay. I'm going to say Siddiqui. I'm going to talk about all my people that were behind the poets, behind the scenes that were making this culture move. This culture move without, you know, without the violence. We were nonviolent, but, you know, every now and again, you're going to have, you know, something going to happen. But we wasn't in control of none of that. We were just trying to have a good time. And we didn't know anything about the elements of hip-hop on the West Coast. To be honest with you, Afrika Bambaataa and Afrika Islam caught me in a club one night and made me a Zulu King. I still have my lion here right now. I'm a Zulu King on the West Coast, and a lot of people don't know that either. You know, until I started speaking when I went to New York, and I went to the Sound Master Crew Hood Day. We had been talking for maybe 40 years on the phone. I never met a lot of these guys other than DJ D, who was in Compton, Richard C, who's still my best friend living in Compton, and Wizkid. And I knew these guys, but I didn't know them guys in New York, man. I talked to them on the phone until I went to their hood day. I went there, and I don't know if y'all ever seen them videos with Rutgers Park and stuff like that, how many thousands of people or hundreds of people would be at those events. I had my Compton hat on. I had on my Compton Soundmasters Crew sweatshirt I made up, established 1979, and start walking. Me and my brother Juan, we walking through the crowd with our gear on, right? And people are looking. I'm like, Soundmaster Crew? They know the Soundmasters. It's like it's over 400-500 Soundmasters, females, guys. It's a lot of Soundmasters, bro. Just Ice, like I said, he didn't even know DJ Aladdin was a Soundmaster. DJ Aladdin is my nephew. DJ Aladdin is a Soundmaster from back then. Everything attached to me is attached to them. King T, Dub C, Aladdin, and other people, you know, that came, you know, by way of what I was doing and got themselves into the music industry, they're part of the Soundmaster Crew. Jeff Ice embraced Aladdin when he was in the DJ competitions out there, like he was his brother. But he didn't know that Aladdin was already attached to him through the Soundmaster. So I went there just to establish that the Soundmaster crews were established in 1979 Compton. Other than the Soundmaster crew being established in 1973 in New York City. Ain't that crazy?
Mm. Mm.
We were the big, we were a crew during the Beef. We were the first before the Posse, before the Syndicate, before the Nation. Before the Zulu Nation, it was us. Before any posse that called itself a posse, it was us, Soundmaster. Before the Syndicate popped, it was Soundmaster. So I went there just to establish that with these guys. Now they got a nice little video documentary on that. Just Ice is him and Trady, their co-host in it. They even put me in it, man. And they let me put in all the hidden treasures of them coming to Compton and establishing that same treasure in Compton, California, in a thing called hip hop.
Hey, Scotty, quick question. Yeah. Were you ever dealing with Ice at any of this time? I know he was hooked up with Zulu Nation too, right, and doing his thing in LA early. Were you ever doing anything with Ice-T?
Oh, yeah. So with Ice was around this man named Cletus Anderson. Matter of fact, Gene spoke with Cletus last night. Me and her were just talking. And I just called Cletus out of clear blue, didn't I, Gene? And he got on the phone and Cletus started running. He just kept going. But Cletus, he was talking about Ice last night, matter of fact. What did he say, Gene? He had throw all the records in the ocean or something? So Ice, he had Ice T. He put out a record on Ice T. He did a lot of stuff. Sugar Frosted Lover. So anyway, his first rap record, his first rap record was with him and Duffy Hooks, was on Disco Daddy. Disco Daddy put a song out, and Cletus and Duffy put that out. That was like 1980, 81. But when he was messing with Ice, I came through his shop because I used to do the music and the mixtapes and stuff like that. So he asked me about helping promote the Ice thing. So I did. And Ice just kept on rapping. He was rapping. So to make a long story short, I never met Ice for maybe about a year or two when Uncle Jen, Roger started letting Ice be on the stage and start rapping and stuff. But that's why I really met Ice. But Ice didn't know that I was into the clothes until I started really busting with myself. The feelings down the arm, the Gucci's and Louis. I started kicking ass from 84 to like 86. They were like, where this stuff coming from? You know, this one thing just in the street. I only had two stores on Halldale and El Segundo, two stores right there. We was busting ass. And Ice and everybody in the whole city was like trying to find out where they was getting this stuff, because some of their homeboys from the West Side, like California Mike and all these dudes, they was wearing the suit. They wouldn't tell them what they was getting. They would come over to us and buy them and sell them back to them for more profit because they knew who was in the dope game. We didn't. You know, we was just like a wholesale group. So when I finally met Ice, he had did a song, and I got King T put over there on Techno Hop through Unknown. That's how I really met Ice, because Ice was trying to do shows. Logic would book Ice in L.A. I would book him in the Valley because I had my shop in the Valley. And that's when I first met Ice, and he knew then, that's that motherfucking nigga named Scotty D. And me and Ice was friends ever since that day, bro. I got him on my film. He's talking about me. He said Scotty was just like a friend of the family. You know, he didn't ever ask me for nothing. I promoted maybe three of Ice's albums. I got my plaques on the walls, you know, Original Gangster and two more albums. But man, Ice is one of the ones, man, that's our West Coast national treasure, man, and needs his Lifetime Achievement Award. That brother did movies first.
Facts.
You know, come on, man. When he came with that band,
Body Count.
Oh man, when he came with Body Count with Beatmaster V and them, man, I was all in with that. I was on the road with that. I was everywhere with that, just for that, because I believed in it. You know, and they were saying something that I like. You know, so yeah, I've been knowing Ice since day one. Ice is the day. Everybody mostly in the music industry from the West Coast, that's OGs. I knew him from day one, from the Rodney Yoder, Joe Cooley. Mixmaster Spade was my right-hand man. I ran Spade record label. You know,
talk about
that's
Spade,
my, that was
please.
My brother, man.
Shout out, rest in peace, Spade. Talk about Spade, please.
Well, I met Spade in 19... before I went to job, of course, like 77, 78. And we wasn't into music like that back then. We was into that street hustling, man. We was into street hustling for a long time until we went to the pen. Now, we was in street hustling. I mean, that dude went to jail and was on the news. You know, they was on the news. What Spade was doing inspired people like Snoop Dogg. We was playing the game, and we were drug dealers turning into rappers. Snoop and them was gang members turned into rappers. So for us to teach the class, somebody has to be a teacher. So by Snoop knowing that, he know how to teach these young boys that's coming up in the game now and young females what it's all about. You know, they had good tutelage. We took care of one another. Spade took care of everybody. Easy took care of everybody. Everybody got that style from a kid named Mix Master Ken. Ken had the first parody tapes out there, reality tapes, I call them. He had the first reality tapes out there on the streets of Compton. You know, he was talking about he would take a song and just flip it. Nightmares on Dwight. You know, then him and Tidy T had a little competition. Oh, I can do better than that. But they were all in one crew behind Spade. And Todd came back with the Batarang. And the rest is history. Them dudes were the first ones to me to do that reality right now. And I know
Yes, sir.
And you know what? And they are Soundmaster crew members because they joined us, the Soundmasters, in 1979. So everything past 1979 that Spade touched, Soundmasters. So that means Toddy T, DJ Vegas, DJ Var, Dan Lockheed, Mitch Master Ken, Toddy T, all them, Black Tie Crew, all them is Soundmasters because they all came through us. Dub C is a Soundmaster because he came through us.
Wow, I didn't know that. Do you think they get their proper respect? I'm sorry, Queen, I just want to ask them. Do you think people like Spade and Toddy T get their proper due respect?
Never. They'll never get their respect until we give them respect. We put them on a pedestal. We make Game talk about him. We make Kendrick talk about them. We can't make nobody doing that because they're not out of sight, out of mind. So that's why it's really significant and God sent for me to continue to say these people's names. Keep putting their names out in the atmosphere so they catch on to, you know, somebody, each one, teach one. So in my film, I talk about them. I give them tributes. It's like this award show, the 50th anniversary of hip-hop. I got to put these guys out there. You know, because Jay-Z and Puffy, all them dudes don't know us, but they live in California. They don't know us. So you can't tell my story about the Dream Team. You can't tell my story about Rodney on Joe Cool. You can't say nothing about the Booyah Tribe. You can't talk about Razzcat. You can't talk about the battle that's been waiting to happen for the last 30 years. The Southland backpackers, like the Freestyle Fellowship, Good Life, the Alcoholics, Razzcat and them versus Hobo Junction, Hill the Funky Homer Station, the Northern Backpackers. They don't know about that battle that's been bubbling for years. And I'm going to bring that out on my Hip Hop Award show, bro. I'm bringing that to life. I'm bringing that. That's the best versus going to happen on the West Coast ever.
Wow.
And I promoted just about everybody I just spoke about just now, man. I went to the Bay, me and DJ Pooh and my cousin Big Pete, to sell some of my sweatsuit in 1985. We got in my Cadillac, and I just drove because my cousin just got out of prison. And I said, look, I'm going to take you past Soledad Prison. You're going to Oakland. Because I met some dudes in Oakland from Job Corps. Hey, Scotty, if you ever get in Oakland, get off on Higginburger and just pull over and ask for me, Mad Nut. I never seen my friend Mad Nut, but I met a lot of people in the Bay, man. I knew Lil D. They would buy, his crew would buy so many sweatsuits from me, man. I met this lady named Renee, and they took me around to some of every place. I met Too Short. I met Mac Mall. Some of everybody, The Click. Ray Love and Spice One, Ed Bank, Sebo Nell, and T. I met just about Marvelous, all the people, Unique, Lady Unique, man, Hillmanor Players, RBO Posse. I met all these people, man. Jason Blaine over at Music People Records. You know, Walter Zelnick up there. Man, I met everybody in the Bay. I met Sway, Tech. I went to Soul Beats. Chuck Johnson, and now the other Chuck is still running Soul Beats. I met some of everybody in the Bay Area, man. Siddiqui, Tamu. Yeah. I met a lot of gangsters out there, too. I don't know all their names, though, but yeah. The Bay was like my second home. I was out there every week. I was out there every week from like 84 to like 87. If you follow, we made a real LA to the Bay connection. Now, we wasn't doing the dope game, but I had a few plugs and I was just mentioning, hey, here. I could have probably went to jail for conspiracy, but I wasn't a plug. I was just plugging. But my thing at that time was just really getting this rap thing going, bringing Two Short Tapes down to LA, not knowing that he had two twin cousins. That was DJs from Uncle Jam's Army. That was DJing for him. Lance and Vance, these dudes, the Kenny brothers, man, them brothers were Two Short's first cousins. Still with them to this day. Never knew how small the world was at that time that we all had to, like, intertwine with this grade called how the West was one.
Right.
Hey, Scotty, would you say you just like I was gonna ask you out of because you've done the music, the promotion, you know, the DJing thing, then you went into clothing, fashion, like you've done it all. But I was gonna ask you out of those, what did you gravitate to the most or like the most? But it seems to me you're just an all around hustler, man. You just gonna do it all and whatever needs to be done. Seems like to me.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't never gravitate to none of it because I was never taught none of that stuff.
Right.
Everything that I've done, I didn't have a mentor. I had a mentor, but his name was Gaylord Hunter. He was from Stack Records. He just recently passed away. Rest in peace, Gaylord Hunter. Stack Records, Al Bell. So he showed me the R&B side, like they would go in with a record in one hand and record and money in one hand and a pistol in the other hand. Play my record or I'm going to see you in the parking lot. So a lot of these dudes wasn't cooperating with us to like play our records on the radio. So I kind of used that mentality in the beginning, but then I started seeing how scary some of these dudes were and they would tell them, put your ass in jail. So I quit doing that. But everything else, man, we had to learn it. We had to lay the blueprint out. So I couldn't gravitate to the street promotion because we made that up. Mm-hmm. I love that more because I helped a lot of more people. I was into that helping business. Like when Twista first came to California, I've been knowing and loving Twista's music before he even came out because he was the fastest tongue in the world. When I met the guy who was running his label and they came to California and the record label would not let them come on a promotion tour with me all around L.A., like going to Watts, going to Long. They wouldn't let them do it. They wouldn't let them do it until one of the dudes that was from Chicago, his name is Big Fub. Big Fub said, "Scotty, look, man, we from the hood. Let's go." And he made it happen.
Right.
Him and Red, they just said, "Yeah, let's go." And we went down there, had a good time. Same thing with the Goody Mob. When they first came to California, they didn't want them to come to Watts and have a soul food picnic.
He made it happen.
We did it anyway. We made them labels. Come on, y'all got to go. And then I'm going to see another one that was really significant. I said the Goody Mob. I said Twista. It was somebody else that really didn't want to. Oh, the Ghetto Boys. How you going to be a Ghetto Boy?
Wow.
I gangster my job to rap a lot. But I didn't know I was walking into the lion's den. I call myself trying to do what I did at Interscope, just walk up in there. I'm gangster. This is my job. This is my city. I walk up in there, and them dudes looked at me like all lying. We was all alpha males up in there. Like, so you really who? This your resume? What you going to do for rap a lot? That's how my dudes saying.
Right.
Like, no. What you going to do for rap? I heard what you did for them. And from that day forward, them dudes love me like I'm their brother, man. Gangster. I'm a straight gangster out of Texas. Mm-hmm.
Wow.
I'm going to tell you how cold they were. What I did with them, I had they had a day where everybody come down to the compound in Texas to kick it with Lil J, eat food, whatever, eat drinks, listen to all the new music. I had a streets team so cold, my guy in Watts was so in love with that Rap-A-Lot project, I let him go in my place. You know what I'm saying? Instead of me going, I let him go. And he, to this day, man, that's my boy, Big Mark. I had a cool crew. I had a cool little street team crew, man. Kate up in Compton, Greedy Green. He's a chef now, one of the best chefs in L.A. He did everybody party. Sophia Gillette, my man, Ali. Ali be on your show all the time. Ali ran my promotion.
I was gonna ask you about Ali. Shout out to Rev Ali.
Rev Ali ran my office. Ali was no groupie.
Right.
I don't know where he came up with that, but he never was around them dudes like that.
Nah, he always say that. He always says that. I wasn't no groupie, huh, Queen? He always say that.
Yeah, he always say that. I wasn't no groupie. I did my business. Hey, you know what I wanted to ask you? We was talking about the Pipers last night. And you know Sugar Free is their family, right?
I didn't know that.
Yeah, Sugar Free is Linda's, which is the oldest girl of the Pipers. That's her son.
Oh, wow. I never knew that.
Yeah. Because I talk to Eddie all the time. And yeah, so Sugar Free is their nephew.
Eddie Piper.
Eddie lives in Vegas now, too.
Them was my guys back in the day. Woo.
Yeah, that's their nephew. That's his nephew. Sugar Free.
I can see where he got it all from now. I can see where he's coming from.
Yeah. Because they used to call their sister Linda, the white girl. They used to call her the white girl, you know, because she was the one who looked more white than any of her sisters. She looked like their mom.
Yeah, that was some good time. But when I stopped the gang stuff and I got into the music, and I'm going to tell you, when I got into it, I would come back to them same neighborhoods that was like full of gang killers. I would pull up on them and I would give them a death row poster. I would pull up on them and give them the new whatever was happening at the time before it even came out. And a lot of them guys got into the music industry because of what I was doing. I would be like, I'm putting up death row stuff way in different neighborhoods. And one day I was at the Congress swap meet. And a limousine was out there, and they rolled down the window and said, "Hey, Scotty D, come here." Who was that? It was Suge and Hen Dog. "Hey, we're doing a boat party. We're doing a boat party this weekend. You got to be there." Boat party? Okay. I went down to the boat party, and some told me.
That's what they told that shit up on.
Don't get on that boat. Yeah. And I was just talking to somebody. I missed it anyway, but because I'm out there running my mouth, you know, doing a promotion thing. I missed I'm glad I did. But I was at every death row event, man. And what was crazy about it, I never got disrespected for being where I was from. None of that, because I did the work. I put the work in.
Right.
She gave us everything we needed to promote that label. That label got me so much money from other companies that, I mean, even when one time the police took my car for putting up stickers. Shug got my car out the impound. So I can't really say a lot of bad things about him because they took care of us. They took care of the street team.
Right.
But they never talk about the street team. We had the biggest national street team the world ever seen. And I'm still in contact with all these guys, man. So Snoop brought me down in December to tell me that he about to get Death Row Records, yada, 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 what he want me to do for him over there or help out. What
do you think about that?
Do I want to do it? It's a good thing whenever he, you know, it's a lot of things that he has to do and be willing to do, you know, to run a whole full-fledged label, you know.
Right,
you can't just get a label and say, I'm gonna run a label comes with staff and, you know, budgets and, you know, it's a lot that goes with that. So, you know, I applaud him just for even taking on the name Death Row. It got a stigma behind it. How are you going to make it different and make it new? And he just did that.
Right.
Without even an act being out. It's just him. solo. Right. I'm standing. I'm taking Paul through it all with him. I mean, I was there from day one. Why not do it again? Let's go.
Right.
Let's go.
Right.
That's his favorite word. Let's go. I'm going. Let's go. You ready to go? Let's go. You know, I'm ready.
Right.
It's going to shoot us that budget and we're going to go. I mean, we promoted that Death Row stuff like it was like next thing coming, man. It was beautiful times. We would do events, man, and Shug would always pick these three people to stay behind and stay in that town and do work, which was me, my man Sir T in Central Valley, and my man Al Robertson out of the Bay Area. We would always stay at How Can I Be Down. We would stay behind. I mean, I did a lot of work, road management work for different labels. I did the Loonies. I had Three Times Crazy. I did a lot of people. Like the Loonies, I got stories. I got this one story. You guys ever heard of Loonies?
Yeah, of course. Yuck Mouth Numbskull. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay. Let me give you a good one. Okay, it was Yuck Mouth Mom's birthday in Hollywood. Mm-hmm. So I said, look, Numb, my partner, DJ Maestro, got a club way out there in Rialto, California. I got to go. You want to go with me? Said, yeah, let's roll. I said, when we leave there, we're going to go back and we're going to go to Prince Club. He said, cool. Prince got a club? Yeah, we're going to go to Prince Club. So we go out to Rialto. We go to my boy party, meet us a couple of people. We dance a little bit. We hung out, and we jump on the floor. We go back to Prince Club. When we get to back of Prince Club, Mixmaster Spade pull up. I'm like, what's up, Spade? So we take pictures and everything. And I'm going to see you inside. I say, okay. So while he come in, I see Big Coco. He's security guard. Big Coco is Prince's bodyguard, and him and Prince coming in the back door. I'm like, Coco,
right.
I got a record for you. Can I get it to you? He said, hold on, Scotty, let me get Prince inside. So he got Prince inside. He come back out. I walk up to the door. I said, look, this is my man record right here. This is Looney's first record. You know, I got five on it. So I like that. Let me see if Prince like it. He went in with the record, came back out. Y'all come on in. We come in. He put us at a nice table. You know, we got some couple of drinks and everything. We're sitting there chilling. And so Coco told me to come in. I come over there. They said, yo, hey, go get that record to the DJ. And then gave the record to the DJ. I gave the record to the DJ. And I turned around, and Coco pointed back at me, tell him, the dude, Numbskull, come over here. Prince wanted to meet us. I come over there with Numb. And we go over there, and Prince said, hey, how you doing? I like your record. And dude put the song on.
Mm.
The song bumping, right? And start getting to the lyrics. Prince stood up and started dancing. But look. That ain't the man. I'm gonna tell you the good part is, Numbskull started dancing with Prince.
Wow.
And he was just dancing. Numbskull was freaking Prince, like getting on him, like
man,
doing
stop
that Bay Area
stop
stuff
it,
all
stop
around
it,
Prince.
Don't
man,
do Numb like
I can't
that,
wait
Scotty,
to talk to Numb. I can't wait to talk to Numb. Numb gonna say, Scotty, I did my thing. I was dancing with Prince, bro. Numb. I've been trying to get on Yuck.
Wow.
I've been trying to get on Yuck's show, but Yuck ain't hit me back yet. I got Yuck them all on film. I have them everywhere. We should go everywhere. I was with them on tour when they got kicked off the Budweiser Superfest, man. Messed up the money.
Wow.
Al told him don't come out on the stage with no liquor, and he did it anyway. And they got kicked off the tour, but yeah. That was one of my favorites. That's one of my good stories. I was on the road with Ahmad back in the days when I was young. I took him around. But a lot of people couldn't go out without their parents' consent because a lot of them guys were young, like King T and them was young. I had to go talk to their parents. J-Roll from Alcohol, I had to go talk to their parents for them to come to be on tour and to take care of these kids. Man, I had a boys' home and didn't even know it. You know, took care of y'all. When I bought clothes for me, I bought clothes for them. It was crazy. Good times, and it was a lot of fun. You know, I just miss my guys like Mixmaster Spade. This stuff wouldn't be going like it is now. You know, it wasn't no drama, no killing. How you get killed at your workplace, man? You know, I see this whole thing just crumbling right before my eyes, and somebody got to. It's nothing I can really say. You know, it's between them and God now. But all I can do is keep doing what my mission statement is, to just keep on having fun, keep making this thing that God put before us to have fun and make money and progress in it. You know, there's a lot of ways to make money in this thing, and it's enough money for everybody, so I don't see where the beef is at.
Great.
You know, especially by me being from California and running into some guys from New York after 40 years, finding out we are still one. This coast to coast.
Right.
And everything in the middle. I've been to Texas. I've been to Miami. I've been to Chicago, Detroit, Ohio. I've been to these different places and seen the culture of how these guys that was with us on death row, you know, evolved in their community. Like we evolved in California. A lot of people that I work with are still doing good things in the music industry. Some of them left their own and went on into different entities in life, you know, to make sure their family still eat. But there's still a lot of money in it. And for these other people to come from New York that hated California, but you come to California and don't put nothing back in the pot, I don't understand that. Even some of the guys that are here that got the money won't put nothing back into the community. I don't know why, but me, I've been spending my money in the neighborhoods, man, and still talking to people, still helping out as much as I can, but I can only do what I can do. And what I'm
and the neighborhoods are becoming so scarce. The neighborhoods are becoming so scarce now, right? That's why it's important, like you said, for the people who have the ability to put money and do things, they need to do it because things are getting pretty scarce in the communities, man. You know what I mean? With the gentrification, just everything.
Like housing, especially housing.
There's nothing left.
Things
yeah.
for these young people to do. There's not a lot for the young. I mean, we grew up on team posts. I grew up in a team post. I grew up in the Boys and Girls Club. You know, we grew up in the park, having fun, doing talent shows and stuff like that. We don't have that resource. We have the resource. We just don't have the people that want to volunteer to, you know, put work in and put in the time to do it. I went to the library and I was researching a lot of stuff in Compton, like who was really from Compton. No, you know, you could say their names, but they're not in books for these kids to read. The librarian at the LA County Library Association, she told me if I ever come up with a book with all this stuff in it, they'll put it in the library. Like I said, I grew up in the library. I worked in Compton Unified School District Library. Yeah. It is what it is. Now, I just can only, like I said, I can only just do my part. And
right.
I'm just glad and healthy and grateful that God touched me to be one of the architects and still be talking about it today. I mean, even Bobcat,
right.
Them dudes were young kids, man. They were young and they were spunky. We had so many good times, man. But they were active in the gang, but the gang left them when they started messing with this music stuff.
Hey, Scotty, we got a special caller on hold for you. We want to bring
you.
You
got my mama?
Oh, no.
Thought it was Mama Ru. Well, Mama Ru be calling in.
Hello, hello, hello.
Hey, how you doing?
Hey, Gene, how you doing?
I'm good. I'm What's doing up, good. G-Lew? I didn't tell Scotty who you was.
What up, dog? What's up, partner? How you doing?
What's going on,
what up,
brother?
What up?
Uncle Scotty, what's going on? What's going on, Uncle Marcus Clayton, man?
Man, I know your voice, nephew. What do you want me to act like? I don't know who you is. What's up, nephew?
What's up, man?
Always you. Sometimes Scotty D, man. Come on, nephew. You know I gotta speak about Pops, man. I don't play.
Yeah, no
I don't
doubt.
Play,
I
man.
Just,
Pops, here with me.
Yeah, I've been listening in. I checked you out on the Uncle Jam's Army Day when you was on G-Lew's show too, man. I appreciate every gesture, man, every word, and it's not even about my pops, man. It's just about the authentic, you know what I'm saying, unfiltered, unbiased view of how all this went down, you know, because in my opinion, you one of the only people left that can really tell it accurately without no incentive to make yourself shine and make yourself be more than, you know, like a lot of cats be doing. I ain't gonna say no names, but yeah, so I just wanted to call in to, you know, let you know I've been listening and I appreciate all three of y'all, you know.
Much love.
Man, much love. Much love.
Man, I love that.
Much love.
I like
appreciate you, bro.
When I hear stuff like that from like people like Marcus that see me come around, hang out with his dad, and still have no filter, no cap on it, that make me feel like I'm doing a good service. I'm doing what I'm supposed to be doing, not what somebody told me. I'm supposed to do this. I'm supposed to try to, you know, hold up that bloodstained banner, you know, for my people that's not here, man. I mean, who gonna do it for me when I'm gone?
Man, I got I got so many stories of seeing you with my dad, man. Y'all was always running. Y'all was never sitting still, man. Y'all was always going out of town, jumping in the car, going to Diego, going to wherever. Like, you know what I'm saying? You really my uncle. Just like when me and Adrian seen you at the Grammy Museum. You know, that was really the last time I saw you.
But
yeah, man.
Even on that show, I had to let it be known. Like, if it wasn't for Roger, I mean, y'all ain't talking about Mr. Clayton enough. You know, y'all gotta put him in it. You can't be all about yourself, because it was never right. about self when we was all coming up. It was everybody. I mean, that man did something that God put him here to do, and he did what he could while he was
good at
it. And was very good at it. I mean,
yeah.
I'm gonna tell you how good his pop was. So brilliant. We would go to events, like say we'd go to any venue, like the Universal Amphitheater. He knew the security guards. He knew the accountant. He knew everybody. Everybody.
Right.
So he showed me some things. When I go to a nightclub and try it again, don't go mess with the promoter. Go to the security guard. And that's how I would get in mostly everywhere I would ever want to go. You get in with the people who are not the main person. Go in with the in the back door. And that's how we rolled. I mean, Roger was a brilliant, brilliant man. And I will always uphold his legacy as long as I'm here. And I'm going to make sure that when we do this West Coast Hip Hop Award show, we have to do it, because it's 50 years. The 50-year anniversary is coming up next year of hip hop, rap. And we have to give it to our iconic people who actually started the game. A lot of people don't know. Before Roger, it was the Watch Properties. They don't even talk about the Watch Properties. Who are they?
No,
they
don't.
Wow.
They came up. They had a rap. They had an album called "Rapping Black in a White World." Come on, how can you have an album called "Rapping Black"? Rapping Black in a White World. That shows me right there. They were doing it before anybody, but they don't talk about it.
Way back when. Yeah.
And them guys are in every book from Harvard to every college you can think of. They're in every posted magazine as being the first rappers before the Watch Prophets. I mean, the Last Poets and all that. It was the Watch Prophets.
Yeah.
Father MD.
Yeah.
And it's cool. So
we talked about
like
him last night too.
We gotta put our iconic people, our treasures, where they're supposed to be at, in the book, on the boulevard, on a star, and that's what my heart is at, man. Don't blame it on my heart. Blame it on the West, because that's where I'm from.
You know what? We got to salute you too, Marcus, because you make sure to keep your father's name legendary. You really put in the footwork to make sure that's happening. So I'm going to salute you personally for doing that. You know what I'm saying?
Thank you. I appreciate that. That's very important to me, because, you know, my dad had 9 kids, and all my much respect to him, but all my brothers and sisters, they really caught up in their own life, I could never do that.
Yeah, you know.
Hey, whoever running the Uncle Jan's, are you running the Uncle Jan's Army page, Mark? Is that you?
Yeah.
Marcus. Hey, Mark,
yeah,
I think we lost him again.
That is him, though. That's him running that page.
Marcus is knocking it down. He's knocking it down. Hey, I need to get Marcus' number, too, because I got to see him some footage I just pulled last night. When I was talking to Eugene,
there we go.
I was going through a bunch of my... Hey,
yeah,
Mark.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
You still got my number?
Yeah, I'm back.
Hey, Marcus, you still got my number?
You run the... go ahead.
Yeah. What'd you say?
Call me when we get off the phone. I want to shoot you something. I found some footage last night. I want you to look at it so you can laugh, man. I saw some good footage last night. But are you running the Uncle Jan's Army page?
Yeah, that's me. I started that. I had to.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we didn't have no visibility. I felt like we didn't have no online presence at all. And, you know, I mean, just like you've been saying, you can't tell the history of rap out here without at least mentioning Uncle James Arvin. Like, I'll be humble about it.
Nah,
you know what I'm saying?
To. You have to.
But, yeah, I mean, I was just thinking a few days ago, you know, the record shop, Scotty, Imperial, Vermont. I was just thinking, I saw, like, so much shit that was just legendary. Like, all right, Michael Conception used to come and visit my dad at the record shop all of the time. And he, because, you know, he's paralyzed from the waist down. So he would literally have to get carried in on some of his goons' back because he always came with about four or five dudes with him. He would always be on somebody's back. And this is in the 90s, like the Pac days. And before I ever saw rappers have Benzes and Bentleys and Rolls Royces and Corvettes and all that, I saw Michael Conception pull up in all of that. And I never even knew who he was. You know, I never even knew who he was. Like, my pops and all of his works got really bigger and more magnified after he passed away. Like, I didn't even really know how big he was when he was alive. You know, I really didn't.
Mike really loved your dad.
Did you know Mike before he was paralyzed, Scotty? Did you know Mike back in the day before he was paralyzed? Okay.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. But see, Mike, when he got into the music game, Roger was always his main man. He would, whatever Roger needed to have done, he would always help Roger do a lot of things, man. Whatever Roger needed, and Mike can help. Roger would go to his people. He knew who to go to make things happen. And Mike just happened to be that dude. I mean, one time he had this thing called a DeLorean, a red DeLorean with the doors pop up and all that. And Roger couldn't keep the car where he was living at, an apartment. So he said, "Scotty, man, come and get this car." And at the same time, Spade got caught up with the police, you know, what they were doing, hustling on the street. So I had to bring Spade truck to my house, too. So I got Spade big-ass orange truck in my yard, and I got Mike Conception's DeLorean in my yard. In the project.
Wow.
that was some crazy time, but, yeah, man. No Roger, no West Coast hip-hop, man. No. Roger did that. He went out to New York, had that meeting with Russell and start bringing them guys out, man. It was incredible, man. We would have 100 tickets for Def Jam and what else? We did everything, the Swash Watch. Man, every tour that came around, Roger had a piece of it. Then the Budweiser Superfest, man, Roger would promote everything. The Cool Jazz Festival. Man, we didn't miss not too many concerts. Roger touched everything in L.A.
I'm gonna be honest with you. A lot of these old school freestyle concerts that you see being thrown now, that's my pop's template for real. Bringing all of those like Lisa and all these freestyle acts and all that, pops was doing that, man.
Oh yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Bring them to the stadium, all out in the valley. Roger was all out in the valley doing shows like that at the skating rings and things. Roger was like that. You could say that. He put that template together, and it was just putting on shows. I was talking to somebody the other night about this event that happened down. Me and Matthew McDaniel was talking about the event that happened in Carson where Jazzy Jeff and the Fresh Prince came down there, right? And I'm like, man, that was Uncle Jam's Army. He said, no, it wasn't.
Right.
I said, yes, it was. Then that was Shamarica Hall. Remember that, Marcus?
Yeah, I got the flyer.
Yeah, Shamarica Hall. Yeah. He didn't know that was the Uncle Jam's Army event, man. So Roger touched a lot. I mean, you can think about any event hall in L.A. from the Olympic Auditorium. Oh, man, Veterans Auditorium. People don't even talk about the L.A. Convention Center. They always say the Sports Arena. Sports Arena, because that's where it got really big at. But before that, it was a convention center, Alpine Village, then the convention center, then Veterans Auditorium in the convention center. It was a lot that went on with that with Roger. Roger was doing stuff all the way up to Oakland. He had friends in Oakland in the Bay Area, Fresno, Stockton, that he would Modesto. We were doing shows.
Lionel B.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
So he's an iconic figure, and he's a national.
Wow.
He's one of our West Coast treasures, and we have to give him his props. And if we don't, we'll be doing a disservice, not just to our West Coast culture, but we'll be doing a disservice to one of the people who actually wrote the blueprint of how this thing is supposed to be. And nobody to this day, yeah, a lot of people have tried to take his place, but you can't. It's no way, because
uh-huh.
you don't have the knowledge of it and you don't put in the work. Roger knew every – Roger, man, who made this song? And he would make your brain think. How can he know every song on a certain album? Who
right.
made it? You can hum the song to him, and he knew who it was. Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah. Right. Man, I was in the Compton courthouse tank and waiting to go to court, and Sir Jinx, DJ Sir Jinx, me and DJ Sir Jinx bumped into each other waiting to go to court, and all these OGs were singing all of these oldies songs, and every song that they sang, I was like, oh, that's the Manhattan, oh, that's the Intruder, oh, that's the Top Listen. And they was like, man, how you know all of that? And I said, man, my family had a record shop on Imperial in Vermont. I had to know that shit alphabetically. And that's actually
sure
the first time me and DJ Sir Jinx ever met, man. Crazy story.
Wow.
I was telling Scotty last night how I used to be at the record shop, and that's where I got all my Timeless collections from what's his name, Scotty? Oh, my God.
Kevin Slow Jammer Jane.
Yeah.
Kevin Slow Jammer Jane. That was Roger Boy, too.
Yeah.
He loved that Jim Daddy.
That was Roger Boy.
Yeah. That was the spot, though, in that little cut. That was the spot. You know, I used to come up there and, you know, Adrian be up in there, me and Tanisa.
Right.
Just be, right. Yeah. Yeah, rest in peace to both of them, you know.
Right.
Wow.
I remember Roger would do these shows. He would do these shows, and he didn't just do Uncle Jam's Army. He would bring in the Dream Team, Egypt. Mm. We were all like one unit, and we would all roll together. It was so much fun with just all of us, you know, hitting the road, going out to different cities, meeting people like Too Short. Too Short come to our party and turn the whole party out with one song. These Are the Ten.
Damn.
The Freaky. Everybody in the whole audience know his song, but they were looking at us like, you know, this dude came in on a halftime show and turned our whole party out. But we would go everywhere.
Wow.
I mean, even when we was on the road with NWA, Roger did a lot of the NWA first shows. You know, we was all in Texas and driving down through Hobbs, New Mexico. You know, we would just, me and Roger stayed on the road. I mean, I didn't mind it. I didn't have a problem driving and rolling with Roger or going out late at night putting up posters, because it was something to do. It was something
right.
to do that I didn't know to this day it was going to benefit us like now to be able to talk about it, of what he did and what kind of legacy he left on the city of Los Angeles. It hasn't been duplicated ever since.
Right.
How did he know how to go down to Kobe and get those posters to light up? But they've been putting up posters since the 60s. But the way we did it, it was totally different.
Hold on, it was
beautiful colors, those fluorescent colors all up and down the freeways, and everywhere you went to, you would see that poster, and it helped you not even go to radio, because at that time, radio wasn't really embracing the culture like that. You know, Roger made radio, you know, get with us. He made radio. These people would all try to get to, all these record labels try to go down to the sports arena and get their record played in front of that audience that didn't even have an opening act. It was all DJs.
Man.
All DJs. No some MCs. That was it. Thousands of kids.
Yeah, man.
Partying.
Look, and to your point, when I was doing security and across from the Beverly Center at the CVS one time, and I looked up, and I seen this big, bald-headed, light-skinned dude with a beard, and he had opened up a bag of chips, and he was eating them already, and he was still shopping. So I walked up to the dude, and by the time I got close, I realized it was Suge. It was Suge Knight, you know what I'm saying? So, you know, I love the game. Like, I love everything about hip hop. So I asked him for a selfie, and he was like, "Nah, man, I don't take pictures." So then I had to double back because I felt like he was dissing me. So I was like, "Man, I'm Roger Clayton's son from Uncle Jam's Army." And he turned and looked at me, and he was like, man, you need to do a documentary on him, man. Your pops used to run the city." I swear that's what he told me. I'll never forget it. And I have so many little stories like that where, like, God has placed certain people right in my face, you know, and I'll bring up my dad, and they always show respect, man, you know.
Marcus, pioneer, legendary.
Did he give you that selfie? Did you get that selfie?
Nah, hell nah. And he was in that red truck that he ran over Terry Carter in too, man. Real authentic story. Yeah, man. I was like, it was about five homeless people waiting outside the front door to ask him for money. Well, it was a trip.
Wow. Wow. Hey, let me take a quick caller right quick.
Just dropping in.
Scotty.
I don't want to stay on too long.
You good, all right, bro.
Marcus.
Hey, we appreciate you calling in, Marcus. Truly, thank you.
No doubt, Gene. I love you. You know, big ups to G-Lew, man. I see you doing your thing, man. I'm going to have to one day get on your show for real, though.
Most definitely. You
for sure.
I've been trying to get
you
on here.
Queen will set it up. Queen will set it up.
No doubt.
Let's do it.
No doubt.
Hey,
all right, for sure.
Marcus,
don't forget, call me, Marcus. I need to holler at you about something.
Okay.
All right. Love
all
you,
right,
man.
I'm still listening, too. All right, later.
All right,
okay.
Homie. Peace.
Love you.
Let
peace.
Me take this caller right here. Caller, hello. Where you at?
What's going on, G-Lew? Man, I had to call in. I've been sitting here listening. I called in, and then I pushed the one, and it didn't do nothing. So then I had to hang up and call right back and push the one again.
See, you got the phone line tied up, man. The phone line lit up tonight. That's got
yeah,
to
you know,
like my son.
I know you got a little time left, you know what I mean? So I just want to be real quick and everything. You know, even when you got Marcus here, you know, I call him Little Marcus because he wasn't no joke when he was like 9, 10 years old, when I used to come into the record store over there when his daddy wasn't there, I had to wait for Roger and them to come back. And I'd be like, "Yo, daddy," and he'd be like, "No, he ain't here."
And Marcus always had that serious look, too.
Yeah, Marcus got that serious look. The little, I'd be like, "Where your daddy at? You ain't here by yourself?" He's like, "No, I ain't here by myself." I said, "Okay." And I'm like, "Yeah, well, you know, I'm over here. I'm supposed to be doing, you know, checking him out for Scotty." He said, "Oh, okay." So then I had to go back out. I go back outside. They got a little soul food spot to the right. You know, you can go over there. They got little pies, and then they got the little other spot across the street. You got to go across the street, though, to go get some of that food. You know what I mean? So I sit there, I'm waiting, and then here come Roger. He show up with Hiroki, the Japanese dude. You know what I mean? And then they show up, and they talking woo-woo-woo. And then I go talk to Hiroki, because Hiroki got some, he want me to get some records from Scotty. So I got Scotty's records. I got the old school mixtapes and the new records and, you know, all these little Black Eyed Peas, new singles and everything. I got to give all that to Roger. You know what I mean? So I'm way out here. It's late. It's about, you know, Roger make you wait, too. He ain't going to as he said, "What's up, Ollie?" "Yeah, okay, hold on. I'm going to get with you. Hold on for a minute. I'm going to help something real quick, Ollie. Hold on." I used to hope I had to meet him at the Lachie Harris spot, you know, at this little club, you know, if I wouldn't have to go way out there off of Vermont. Man, boy, I'm telling you, boy, Roger Clayton, oh, my God, man. That was one of the best dudes in my life. He knew, like Scotty said, Duffy Hooks. He knew my other people's Andy Belvin. They was old record dudes that knew, you know, but back in the, like, the records that Marcus was talking about that he had to learn. You know, you got to know that old school stuff when you're working in them record stores because you got to make a sale real quick. You know, Marcus, he was on it, though. 9, 10 years old, doing it big for his daddy, man. So when he say, whatever he say now, it's legit to me because I saw him when he was 9 and 10 doing it, standing in the record store with his dad and really was serious about it. So, you know, that's a real kid to me, man. Anyway, Rev Ali here, man. What's up, Scotty? What's up, G-Lew? What's up, Queen Jean? You know what I'm saying? Push-ups, hugs, and everybody. You know how we do
much
it. No
love,
meat.
Ali.
No
much
meat.
Love.
Much love. Much love, Ali. Much love, Revy Rev.
Hey, that's another one of my sons. He called himself Scotty D. Some. Make a long story short, I met Ali. He was standing outside in my nephew Aladdin's apartment building. And I kept
DJ
looking at him.
Aladdin.
Yeah, DJ Aladdin. We was doing. He was working on Ice-T record. Plus, he had his own little thing coming out. We had two Cadillacs. You know, we was looking fly every day, and Ali would just be looking at us. So one day I said, "Hey man, you know, hey, why don't you take these records or something like that?" And I put him on. And I said, "Look, I got this Ice-T movie that nobody else has. It's called Ice TV. Ice is talking about all the old black pimp movies back then." So Ali came to the apartment, and Aladdin got mad because he didn't know Ali and he didn't like Ali. So I brought Ali in. I opened up a little promotions office down the street, and I made Ali my promotions manager. He ran the office, and we still together to this day.
Wow.
You know, my family, he used to put together my Christmas trees for my kids, my bikes and stuff for the kids. And, you know, I gave him his little Christmas present, have a couple of dollars inside of a wallet. Him and my boy Billy Boy ran my stores. You know, first I had a promotions office, and I started opening a record shop like Roger. And, Ali was a good dude. He never was like no groupie. We would go to all kinds of events. You know, Ali learned how to get in them events too, just with a Platinum Street promotion card. He'd walk in because he knew how to conduct himself back then.
Mm-hmm.
He wasn't out there trying to be all, he was just doing the work, you know, for the promotion company. He ran the office real swell. Ali's a good dude. Really good dude. Matter of fact, all of us, the last time we were all together, we was in San Diego. Ali had moved to San Diego. And Rodney did a lot of shows in San Diego. So he said, "Who we got in San?" I said, "We got Ali down." I said, "Oh, okay, give me Ali's number." So he called Ali, put Ali on. So one day I was working on my film, How the West Was Won. I said, "Ali, I gotta interview you." And I was going to a football game. Plus, Roger was doing Tina Marie, Lisa, and what's the other girl name? It was three ladies on one show. Right before Tina passed away. And Roger
Trinier.
It was Trinier, Lisa, and Tina Marie. So we do the show. The next morning, I'm going to the football game, so I got Ali with me, and we're doing an interview. Roger and I stayed at the same hotel, and him and Barney, Big Barney from Compton, the mayor of Compton. We sitting down, we chilling, and Roger kept, "Scott, you all right?" And he kept coming in on the interview asking me, "Are we okay? Do we want some breakfast?" Well, I said, "Yeah, give me a little for breakfast." Roger went and got the breakfast, but he kept coming in. So we got all that on film of Roger coming back and forth, interacting with us while we were doing Ali's interview. And right after that, you know, Roger passed away. So we got, matter of fact, the last time I saw Roger was right before he passed. I had let him use my car. I went out of town to have some business. So his car was in the shop. So I said, "Man, just drop me off and keep my car until I come back, and just pick me up when I come back in." He said, "Cool." So he's doing the work, and I think he was doing the Key Sweat concerts. And he told me, "Look, when you're coming back, let me know." So he picked me up on Saturday afternoon. And he said, "Look, if you stay and we can DJ this party tonight, I'll give you, say, $250. I'm like, "You going to give me $250? "Oh, yeah, I'm doing it. Whatever it is. You know, Roger ain't never gave me no money, you know." Roger never, because I never wanted that. I always kept my own money. He said, "I'll give you $250. "When we doing a house party?" He said, "Yeah." I said, "Cool, we go and do this party." Oh, man, I had never had that much fun, just he and I by ourselves together at a house party way out in, like, Rancho Cucamonga or something. Roger was in rare form, and I had my video camera. I recorded the whole house party. He gave me that money. We went back home. I dropped him off, put the equipment back in the shop, and I left. And then I had to go back out of town. When I'm out of town, I got the news, man, from my brother, man. He was gone, and that just devastated me. But they let me speak at the service. They let me speak at the service. You know, only a few people got to speak at it, so I happen to be one of them. His family asked me to do it. Like I said, that's why I'm not going to stop doing this How the West Was Won film. because I have to. It's not because I want to. Days I be wanting to give up because I'm paying for it out of my own pocket. I don't have a sponsor, but once it's all done, all that stuff will come. But in the meantime, putting it all together, you know, through memory and research, it's a big job. It's a big job, and I've been doing it for the last like 15 years. But now it's time because hip hop, the 50th anniversary is next year, and everything is falling into place, you know. And I just love the way that Marcus came in. It's all God. I didn't ask Marcus to call. Y'all didn't ask Marcus to call. That means Marcus
no.
got love. Craig Swazinger, come on, man. Craig is like, that's Compton. He ran the, man, World on Wheels. That's one of the iconic pieces of history in Compton. He called in just to say, hey, y'all, how y'all doing? What's up, Scotty D? I'm still here. He's part of our film
Amen.
Also. You know, I got Craig and skating. I got the skating rings. I got bodybuilding. I grew up on bodybuilding. I grew up on gangs and I got street promotions. I got even the street racing. People don't know we had L.A. street racing was big back in the day over there on Florence and Maine. Yeah, then I got all the after hours. I talk about the after hours with Doobie and BJ. These guys are real iconic figures. The first person I took over to the after hours was Charlie Murphy. End up seeing Rick James and Bobby Womack and all the other people at the after hours later, you know. But make a long story short, then I have a low riding. Who was the first people in L.A. to do low riding? And we have, I got every piece to not make the story boring. I have the whole West Coast story. Who was the first one from the Bay to L.A.? Being I even also put together this piece about the Inland Empire. People don't know, our sister city was the I.E. DJ Maestro, DJ Sean, Grover Wembley, Groove Time Records, you know, Al the Bandit. All, there's a lot of different elements, you know, all these different DJs would all come down and want to be with Uncle Jam's Army. Uncle Jam's Army would start going out to Pomona and doing shows and different places out there. Because Roger knew what he was doing. Roger was moving around. He wasn't sitting around twiddling his thumbs. Roger stayed moving around, meeting people, and doing what he did best, which was bringing people together to have a good time.
Right. Legendary. Rest in peace,
that's
man.
What they don't talk about. Nobody talk about the IE other than, above the law. No, it was stuff going on before them. It was stuff going on way.
And Rodney O from there, too?
Yeah, Rodney O from out that way also.
Yeah.
Two Live Crew. Brother Marquise and them, they come out that way. They got somebody. He was from the IE.
Right. You are the history, Scotty. You so much, man. I think we're out of time, but man, we need to like Quinn. We need
a
part two.
Man,
Scotty. We ain't even seem like we halfway through.
Mm-hmm.
But we're out of time.
You
gotta
think about it.
We gotta do this again, Scotty.
I got 40
we gotta
do a part
two.
I ain't mad at you because I can't smash 40 years into an hour conversation.
Right.
That's why how the West is one is layers, it's pieces of it, episodes of that. Piece. It's never really it's a never ending story of how the West was won. But we have to lay the foundation. The foundation got to be laid first with our national West Coast treasures and our iconic figures before we go anywhere further. We have to lay the foundation to who our founding fathers were and Roger Clayton, Duffy Hooks, Calvin Anderson, a lot of different people have to be mentioned. The Watch Prophets, they have to be acknowledged before we can go any further.
Right. Facts.
Totally
well,
agree.
Scotty, we're going to do this again very soon. Whenever you're ready, I want to do this again. I'm sorry the time has ran out. I could just let you go on. But before we do that, let me take one more caller because they've been holding on for a minute, and I don't want to miss them. Looks like a 314 St. Louis number. You're live on the air. Hello.
Appreciate it. I'll make it quick since y'all have to go. To Scotty, if you were going to do some street promotion in 2022 or try to break an artist record now, or like you say, help Snoop, would you use the same blueprint you was using back in '90s? Is it still the same blueprint, basically, and you just tweak it or no? When a different time, you'll have to come with a different approach, a different technique to break a record?
Well, that's a good question, because what we were doing would never go away. Never. It's just right now the internet is so powerful, and that's what everybody is. You have to use that. You have to use the internet. But people still drive their cars. They're going to see that poster on the freeway, right on the freeway, off-ramp and on-ramp. You're going to put a poster up in the barbershop. It's never going to go nowhere because nobody puts posters up anymore. So that element of the game called hip-hop will never go away. They call it dinosaurs and whatever. No, it will never go away, and it's still a marketing tool to promote your act. Getting those flyers in them kids' hands at school. All that stuff, because they don't do it no more. So it's brand new. Everything has a cipher. It's a cipher. It goes back around 360 degrees. So it'll never go nowhere. And it is what it is. I would always use that technique, but I would also implement the internet part of it also.
Okay, I appreciate you answering that question. I'll be ready for part two if you come back on.
Cool. Appreciate
it, man. We're doing that soon. Yes. Yes, sir.
Okay, right on. Thanks. Appreciate it.
Much
thank
love,
you for
homie.
Calling.
All right.
All right, peace.
Okay, man, Scotty, dude, we got to bring you back.
Yeah.
Man, y'all back next week. Bring me back next week. I'm with it.
Hey, well, okay. we could probably
I told
do
y'all
that.
About the
we might have to do that.
Y'all had it formatted.
Yeah.
Now, I'm going to be ready for you next week. I'm going to be ready for you. But I could just let you go, man, because you were like, it was like a book tonight. It was like we were reading a book tonight, man. And it was like, I was all into it, man. So, like Scotty said, well, I think we'll do it again next week. So, everyone tune back in there. This great lesson of history.
Yep.
Much
Queen
love,
Scotty.
I know they're going to cut me off. So much love.
All right, y'all. Thank y'all. Thank you, Gene. Thank you, G-Lew. God bless y'all, man. Y'all stay safe, stay covered up, regardless of what they're talking about. And I'll see y'all next week.
All right. I'll give
for
you a call.
Much love.
Then.
All right. Peace.
All right.
I'm back
peace.
Quiet.
All right. Peace, y'all. Much love, everyone. Thank you for another edition of Westside Wednesdays radio show. Special guest Scotty D. Spencer, the legendary DJ Scotty D. I am G-Lew. That's Queen Jean. Tune in next week. We'll be back to do it again. And also Friday night, Queen Jean and Cousin Marcy. Queen Jean, take us out of here.
All right. Peace and love to everybody. Be safe. Say your prayers, and we'll talk to you soon. One love.
Peace.
And we can get high, y'all. Never know when we gon' die, y'all. Come smoke one with us.